Okay, so we're ready to look at writing a CNC program. What we're going to do is start with an example. All right, so what we want to do is take a piece of aluminum that's 5 inches wide, 2 inches tall, 6 inches long, and it will be mounted in a vise. And what we're going to do is just take an engraving tool and drop that engraving tool down and scratch a line around, scratch a square in that block. And the engraving is going to be 20 thousandths of an inch deep. And we've given ourselves some tolerance here, so when we talk about our setup, that will be enough. We'll be able to get the tolerance we need to easily hit these nice, generous tolerances. So this is the setup. This is the goal that we want to have. When we finish, we want to take just this pointed tool and first position it here 2 inches above the block, and then drive it down so that it's 20 thou below the surface, so it's actually machining some. And we're going to go up and around and down and back over and then back out like this. All right, so that's going to be our goal for writing this program. Okay, this is a header that's similar to the header that we'll use in class. It's not identical. There's a few things that are different, but this, what we're going to do is step through and talk about what all is being fixed by this header. Okay, so up until now we've just kind of said, don't worry about it. This header is taking care of all those things, and all you need to worry about is your X and Y and Z moves. But now we're going to see a little bit more about what's going on in this header. What are these codes actually doing? All right, so let me just grab my version of that header, and you can see somewhere in here, we've got G17 right here. So we've asked for G17 mode in this header, and it's saying here the explanation is plain. That's a little bit cryptic. One reason is you can only have so many characters in a comment. I don't think I mentioned that before, but you can't just put everything that you want to in these comments. If the comments get too long, then the controller can't handle it. So anyway, we're selecting the plane here with G17. Well, what does that mean? That means that when we start drawing arcs, when we start programming arcs and circles, they can exist in one of these three planes. Okay. So later on in this lecture, we're going to look at programming some arcs, and all the arcs that we're going to program really in this class are going to be on the XY plane like this, so they'll all be G17 arcs. Now we could, if we were making like a boat hull or something like that, and we're coming in here and machining a whole bunch of arcs in this direction, we might want to use G18. So arcs, and if G18 is enabled, would be in the XZ axis, and if we had enabled G19, they'd be in the YZ axis. All right, so that's what the G17 is about. The G20, that puts us into inch mode. There are different ways, different controllers will do this a little differently, but for this entire class, G20 is what we want. We are not going to go with anything other than G20. Let's see, G40, that's going to clear out any cutter length compensations. So we'll turn it off here. We're going to cancel any tool length compensations. But then later we're going to turn right back around and enable our own G43. We'll talk about what this means. That's going to enable the length compensation for the tool that we're using. We're going to use tool 8 in this case. Now G55 we have already talked about. Let's see, where does that fall in here? Yeah, there we go. G55, we've already talked about everything. If it's G54, G55, anything up to G59, that's telling the controller which part zero offset to use, so where to place the origin on the machine, on the physical machine. Okay, so that doesn't, nothing more than G55 gets mentioned in the program, but in the controller, the setup person has to go through the steps of assigning where G55 is located, and we'll talk a little bit about those steps here just momentarily. Let's see here. G80 will cancel any kind of canned cycles that might have been active, because you see, if somebody had run a program before this program and they had done, well, what's a CAN cycle? A CAN cycle is like a PEC drilling operation where you go in and you drill, instead of saying Z up and Z down over and over again, you tell the machine how deep you want the hole and how deeply you want to go in with each PEC and things like that. So this clears out any of that. So if we accidentally give, say, an XY location, then instead of putting G01 or G1 in front of it, if we just said an XY location and the last program that ran had done some canned cycles, like drilling, it would go to that location and just start drilling. And that's definitely not what we want to do with this. And so that's why, where is it? The G80 is in here to clear any of those canned cycles out. G90, again, we've talked about this. I've got a slide dedicated to this to talk about it again, because it's just fundamental that you understand the difference between absolute and incremental coordinates. Let's see, what else do we have here? G94, where is that dumb thing? It may not even be in this header. But if it was in there, and it should be in there, I might need to be updating that. That puts our feed rate in units of distance per minute. In our case, it'll be inches per minute. There, it's fixed. Okay, so instead of what we could have instead of inches per minute would be to use like lathe feed rates, which would be inches per revolution. So you can actually program your cutter to go a certain number of inches per revolution instead of inches per minute, but that's a little unusual. So we're going to stick with G94 there. Then G43, like I said, this is going to turn the cutter compensation, the tool length compensation on. Okay, we'll talk about other ways we'll need to compensate for the tool later on, but today we're just going to talk about the length, how we can compensate for the length, and we're really only going to take a shortcut for that. All right, so here's a little bit more detail on some of those. One that needs to be gone over again, because it's just so darn fundamental, is the whether we're using G90 or G91, the difference between absolute and incremental programming. Here is some code snippet that both of these codes start at the same start point, -3 in the X and +1 in the Y. So if we're located here and we're in G90, we enable absolute mode, and then we execute this line of code, G1, X3, Y2, F8, then it will move to the position X3, Y2. Okay, so it will position to the actual coordinates 3, 2, or X3, Y2. If we have G91 enabled, then what it will do is move the tool 3 inches and move the tool 1 inches in the X and in the Y axis. Okay, so G91, X3, Y2 means move over 3, move up 2 from where you were. G90 doesn't care where you are, it takes you to a specific point in space. So that's just a refresher on that. Very important to understand. All right, now the G55, and again, this could be anything G54 through G59. These are telling our controller where the origin is. Okay, so we have asked in our code right here for G55. Okay, and it's up to us to indicate to our setup person where G55 is on the machine. Okay, and so we've asked for it to be right here at this edge. So what the setup person is going to do is they're going to put an edge finder or a probe or something like that. Let's just talk in terms of edge finders. We've said we've given ourselves plenty of tolerance, so we don't need anything fancier than this. But we put this edge finder in, and typically edge finders have a 0.2-inch diameter cylinder on the end. We'll come in here, we'll touch off with that edge finder, and we will be 0.1 inches away from the edge. It's then our job to jog up and over that 0.1 inches to align ourselves with the what's going to become the y-axis origin. That is, this edge of the part is going to become our y-axis origin. This edge, which is the x-axis, is the place where y is equal to 0. Okay, so all along this edge, y is equal to 0. And this is how we set that. First, we position the tool in that position, and then we'll go to our controller, we'll hit the offset button, and we'll get onto the offset screen. So we'll hit offsets. It will take us to the active work offset screen. We will highlight the x-axis on G55 and we'll press part zero set. Okay, and again, we're doing that with the tool in this position. It's aligned in the right spot. And we come in here, we say part zero set. Now, what the heck is this number in here? All right, that is where the machine's x-axis is located in its own machine coordinate system. All right, on the model that I use, I have put a coordinate system on there. I've put the machine coordinate system on the actual ways, okay, on the actual table in this case. And this is a pointer. The pointer doesn't move, but when the axis moves, when this vise moves left and right, it slides this scale past that pointer. So when the machine is in its home position, when it goes all the way to home to 000, this zero will align with this pointer. Okay. In this case, the table has been jogged over some, and you can see that it's just a little bit past 17. And these are negative coordinates, okay? And here we see that the machine's coordinate system is at negative, at the x, negative 17.0238. In general, you don't even really need to pay attention to these numbers. You could get away with not knowing what they were, okay? But I think that's a little bit dangerous, and so I think it's important to know why this number 7, negative 17 something, is in there, okay? Notice if we were to use the other side of the block here as the x-axis origin, we would be scooted over. The table would be slid over in this direction, and we'd have something like negative 13 would be the value in here. Okay, so understanding how that works will kind of guide you. All right, and then this was the image we saw earlier aligning the y-axis. We move the find the y-axis origin, so we touch off on the edge. We use the edge finder. We get that y-axis, and we're on our offset screen. We will take the cursor and highlight the y-axis on G55, and we'll say part zero set. And what the machine will plug in there automatically is its own y-axis position at that point in space. Okay. So now, when we want to use, come back up here, when we want to use this G55 XY origin, all we have to do in our code is ask for G55, and we entrust the setup to the setup person. And of course, we have to communicate that to them, that that's where we want it to be. Now, there's a Z axis also. I'm not going to talk about that today. What we're going to do is leave that zero for right now. Later I'll talk about machine setup, and we'll talk about a much better way of dealing with this zero than what I'm about to show you. All right, but we need to accommodate our tool length, because right now we've only settled X and Y. We need to be able to handle the length of the tool. So in our code, you see that we're asking for tool number 8. Later on down here, we turn the tool length compensation on, and we ask for value H. A value 8, so H08 for the tool length. Now let me show you what that's going to do. Okay, this is just an aside. Lathes have a different format for this, so if we're talking lathes, we're going to do a different format. I'll just kind of stub out and say we're going to talk about that later. What we need to be concerned with right now is that the tool number and the offset number, the H number, most of the time those will need to match. Our controller in the lab downstairs on both machines ask for this. They require it to match, so they won't run a code. They won't run a program where these do not match. So shortcut in this class, always make sure that your T number and your H number are the same number. Okay. Now, in reality, it doesn't always have to be that way, but for this class, it does. All right, notice also, I'll say this is the note down there, that just saying tool number 8 does not put tool 8 in the spindle, okay? It is not in the spindle until we do an MO6. All right, you can see here, we ask for the tool change to happen after we call the tool, okay? So first we call the tool, and then we command the tool change. The tool change doesn't happen until we call the MO6. All right. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you how we can set that tool length offset, and I'm going to do this just this one way, just this one time. It is a shortcut. We might even do this in lab for your maze program and maybe for your initials program, but it is a shortcut, and it's not maybe that dangerous, but it is definitely inefficient. Okay, so this is not the best way of doing this, but for purposes of understanding it, I think it's a good way to start. Okay, so here's what we're going to do. In our work offsets, this is where we set our G55. We're going to leave this G55 Z value as 0. Okay, if it's not 0, we could type in 0 and hit F1 and set this to 0. Then we're going to come to our tool offset page. We're going to jog the cutter that we're going to use, the actual engraving tool that we're going to use on this aluminum block. We will jog it down. And a lot of times what people do is they'll put a piece of paper on the surface here, and they'll change the jog increment to something very, very fine, like 10 thousandths, and they'll jog down until that cutter starts to drag on the piece of paper, maybe take off an additional 2 or 3 thou, and set the tool length offset there. We're just going to pretend, this very bad form, but we're going to pretend that we're just taking the engraving tool and we're jogging down until it just touches this surface. All right, so just theoretically, bear with me. We're going to pretend that's what we're doing. We're touching that engraving tool off on the surface of this aluminum block. I know that's not a good idea, but we're just going to do it. And then we'll go to our tool program, our program tool offsets, okay? And the way we get to this is we hit offsets once to get to the active work offset, and we hit it again, and it will toggle us to the tool offsets, okay? We will go down to tool number 8, and we will highlight the H column, the geometry out of the H. We'll highlight this with the cursor, and we'll press, there's a dedicated button on the machine. Let me scroll back up to that. All right, where is that thing? Tool offset measure. Okay, it's going to be right there. So you'll press that tool offset measure, and let me go back. What will go in there is this number, okay? Now you might be able to guess what that number is. Look on this on the machine, and we'll see that the machine is positioned at its own very close to -5 inches. And you see this answer, or this entry here, very close to -5, a little bit less than -5 inches. That is the tool length offset, okay? I'll say it again. There's going to be a different way of doing this, and you'll see that it's a much better way. But for now, you can see how it's being compensated for. So when we send the tool to X0, Y0, and now Z0 with our tool 8 enabled, with our length compensation turned on, with G55 enabled, we can program. Let me just drop back up here. If we were to go to X0, Y0, Z0, now the tip of this tool would go right to that spot, okay? And sometimes that's what we'll do to just check and make sure we've got the right things programmed. Of course, we won't do 0, 0, 0. We'll do something like X0, Y0, Z.1, something like that. So we'll jog to just above that spot. Okay. So that's how we get control over our X and our Y and our Z now with that tool. All right. Sorry for all the flicking back and forth. All right, then somewhere along the line, we've got to set the spindle speed. So that gets done with this S, this little S address and this number 1500. So this is going to set the spindle to 1500 RPM. It will not turn the spindle on, however. Okay, the spindle doesn't come on until down here and we hit this MO3. That's going to turn the spindle on clockwise. All right, we can reverse it and go counterclockwise with an MO4. And we can turn it off with an MO5. There are also buttons on the machine that we can use to turn the spindle on, off, and reverse the direction. All right, now, we could have also put in here MO8, and that would have been that would turn the coolant on. So we can just say MO8. Now we've turned the coolant on. And of course, that's the stuff in the parentheses. As you know, those are just comments, but the MO8 does the job of turning the coolant on. So if we wanted to use coolant on this operation, it would go right there, or at least somewhere before we started cutting. You do want to have it well before you get super close to the place where cutting begins, because what you don't want to do, there's going to be a little lag between the time you turn the coolant on and the coolant actually gets up to the nozzle and starts spraying on the tool. And what you don't want to do is heat the tool up by cutting and then splash it with cold coolant. So that's the thermal shock is worse sometimes than just not having coolant at all. All right, so give it time to flow up there. All right, where did that come from? We've already done this, right? Okay. All right, so let's write the program to come in here and do this. We go down, up, and around. But the tool's not positioned here. So keep in mind, your program's going to pick up and draw all these black lines, but you don't know what it's going to look like before your code executes, because this tool could be up and over. It could be anywhere. Okay. Now, in this assignment, we're going to make the assumption that the tool is up at a safe Z level. If you don't know that, it's always good form, depending on, you know, the situation that you're in, is to put a safety move in there to always move maybe the Z up and the Z axis up to something like, you know, whatever, 10 inches, something like that. Some level that you can actually take it to. All right, so what we want to do first of all, the tool could be anywhere, okay? It could have any X and Y and really Z location. Like I said, the assumption is, though, that it's at a safe Z for our purposes. And what we want to do is we don't want to waste a lot of time moving really slowly at a feed rate to where our code begins. We want to rapid our way here. So we're going to have a rapid. That's a G0 move that will go to X4, Y, -4, Z2.0. So it's going to take the tool to this starting point. All right. So there's this sort of unknown place where the tool is currently. We're going to take it to a known spot, and we're going to do it fast. We're going to use G0. That is a rapid move. It will, what it does is what it doesn't do is move in a straight line. Okay, so let me get that said first. It does not take the cutter in a straight line to this point. What it does is it will move the X motor as fast as it can until it's in the right X position. And it will move the Y motor as fast as it can until it's in the right Y position. And it will move the Z motor as fast as it can until it's in the right Z location. All right, so this is a real common sticking point. If this were our starting point and we used a G0 move to go to here, X positive 4, Y negative 4, if it had been a G1 path like we programmed before with our maze, yeah, it would just go along in this direction at the feed rate, whatever the commanded feed rate is. But if we do a G0 move, it is going to go hauling ass down in both the X and the Y directions as fast as it can. And here you see the X-axis motor runs out first, the Y-axis motor runs out first, and the X-axis motor continues to go at full speed until the cutter is located at this point right here, which is where our program is going to begin. All right. Now, the thing is, if you didn't know that G0s did this, what's going to be positioned right here? That's right, a vise or some large piece of metal is going to be positioned right here. That is the law of the vise. Okay. So you have to understand that rapid moves do not move in straight lines. They run both motors, or all three motors, really, full speed until they're in their commanded position. Very important that you understand that. It'll be on the quiz. All right, so let's see. Anyway, we said that, remember, the tool can be anywhere, so it's a good idea to go up in the Z to some safe Z-level position first of all, but we've said in our case that is on our list of stated assumptions that the Z-level is safe. All right, so now a little bit of review. We're going to program a G1 to go down, up, over, down, over, and back up. Okay, this is to complete what we said we were going to do in the starting bit of this assignment. Okay, so remember, our header is all still up here. I just didn't repeat the header over and over again. We stepped through the header, so we know what's in the header. And now we can say, here's our rapid move to this position right here. And then we say G1, Z negative 0.02, feed rate 10 inches per minute. So it's going to feed. It's going to take a while to get down there. In this class, though, we are not about speed, not yet, okay? So we're going to take our time. We're going to move gently down and get down to the machining position of negative 20 thou. And now we're going to be touching this. It's a very common mistake for somebody to put in here. They'll think, oh, I'm already at X4, Y -4. My next move is to go here. And what they'll do is they'll put X4, or just leave it blank, Y -1, and they'll put the Z move in here at the same time. This is why I had you not do any ramping in the maze problem, because what that will do is if you do X and Y and Z at the same time, instead of going down and then up, it will go down and up, and it will ramp across like that, and that's not what you want. So we have this dedicated Z move to go straight down first of all. All right, and then what we'll do, then we'll step around and do the rest. So here we have a Y move. Again, we don't have to repeat the feed rate because we've already established the 10 inch per minute feed rate. We don't have to repeat G1 because it's modal and it will stay G1 until we undo that with something like a G2 or G3, which we'll get to in a little bit. All we need is the Y move. So the Y moves up to negative 1. It doesn't move down. Okay, remember, we have G90 enabled, so it goes to the position where X or Y is equal to negative 1. Then we command it to go to X negative 1, so it will move across in this direction. And then we have it go to Y negative 4, so it will go down to the Y negative 4 point. And then X positive 4 from right here, it will go over to there. Then finally, and separately, we will command a Z2.0 to go back to the place where we started from. All right. So if we were to run this program twice in a row, the rapid move wouldn't happen on the second time we ran it because it would already be at the place at this spot right here. All right. And then we have the footer. This is just a comment. It doesn't do anything. It just says this is the end of the code that I edited in here. The M30 is a program stop rewind, so that rewinds the tape, or what it does in the 20th century or 21st century now is it will reset the controller, and that way we can run this code a second time by just hitting cycle start. We won't have to hit reset cycle start. All right, and then we should end safely and pull up. And M2 will just end the program, but M30 is what I always use. That seems to work a little better. Of course, you want to safely retract before you do the M30. Maybe I need to change those notes. There we go. That's better. So safely retract and then do your M30 at the end. All right. We need to talk about arcs. This is really new stuff, and this is what you're going to have to master before you do your initials assignment. Okay. So your initials assignment has to include a G2, it has to have a G3, and it also has to, we're going to talk about two ways of doing these, IJK method and R method, and your assignment will have to make use of both the IJK and the R method. It will have to use a G02 and a G03. But I'll leave the assignment lecture up to the assignment, okay? But this is how you program arcs, okay? First of all, a G02 is a clockwise arc. G03 is counterclockwise. These are motion at a feed rate, just like a G01, so they'll have to have a feed rate. And they'll borrow the feed rate from the G01 if it's already been enabled. All right, let's first look at the G02, G03 using IJK method, okay? If you keep everything straight and you're very careful about where you position your points, then this is not terrible, okay? It can easily be understood. The problem comes in where students try to take small liberties in calculating where points are located, the X and Y values of points and the X and Y values of the IJ and K. So first of all, make sure you always calculate carefully and round to the fourth decimal place. You always have to be correct all these numbers for the GO2, the GO3, and whether you're using IJK or R method, which I'll talk about in a minute. You always have to have the points calculated properly and correctly to the fourth decimal place. Okay, what is I, what is J, and what is K? I, J, and K are the distance from where you started machining the arc to the center of the arc. Okay, I is in the X, J is in the Y, K is in the Z. We will hardly ever use, in fact, in this class, I don't think we ever use the K. We'll just use I's and J's 99.9% of the time. All right, so here is an example. And this is separate from our other example that we worked. Okay, this is just basically for your initials project. All right, here is the code. First of all, is this a clockwise or a counterclockwise arc? We're going to start at P1, go to P2. We're going to make this arc. That is a clockwise arc, so we will use G2. Okay, what we're going to command in a G2 is the ending position. Okay, so this X2.0 is the end position. Let's see how we got to there. Okay, first of all, we said G1, X-2, Y-2, Z0. So that means the machine, oh hell, it's going to ramp, but I think that's going to be okay. All right, for purposes of discussion, I think you understand what that's doing. It's going to move X, Y, and Z until it touches here at point one. Terrible form, but for to make things go faster, I did it that way. Okay, so here we are at P1. We're on the surface at X-2, Y-2, and then we say, all right, go to P2. To get to P2, this is just a G1 command, nothing new here. We go to Y+1, so here goes our tool, moves to Y+1. This is the start point of the arc, okay? We never command the start point in a G2, we only command the end point of the arc. So the end point is 2 inches over in the X. There's no change in the Y. So, I'm sorry, it's not 2 inches over. It is at the, because we're in G90, it is at the X2.0 position. So that's X1, 2, and here we are, okay? So this is the end point of the arc. Then I and J, well, let's just look at I first of all. I correlates to the X axis. These follow alphabetically like we discussed. I is 2 inches over from the start point. So the center, remember what we said? We said that I is the distance from the start point. It's the distance from the start point to the arc center point in the x-axis. Here's our start point. Here's the center point. That is over +1, 2 inches. Okay? You can think about it as being incremental. All right, 2 inches over in the I. Now the J is listed here as 0. We could have just omitted it altogether, but just to make a point, the distance in the J, that would be the Y axis. So the difference in Y from the start point to the center point is 0. So our J is 0, and again, we could have just simply omitted that, and that's probably better form to just omit it. And this will take us to point 3, okay? This is funny because sometimes, because remember, this I and this J are pointing, they're saying this is a distance from somewhere that's not even in this line of code. You have to step back, in this case, 2 lines of code to see where your current X, Y position is, where the P2 position is. And they're using that point. I and J are saying from that point, from where this arc started, to the center is 1 unit or 2 units over in the x-axis. So I value of 2. But anyway, this will work, okay? Let's see. Notice that the y value of P3 is the same as the y value of P2, so it gets omitted. That's why there's no y in here. And so, again, we could have also left out the j. All right, so what are I and j again? Here they are labeled on here, okay? We went from P1 to P2, then we commanded the arc. So we were sitting here at P2 when we asked for a G2 move to go clockwise to this destination, X2, and of course, the Y1, because it didn't change. It's still this Y1. So that took us to P3. We pointed to where the arc's center was from the start point of the arc, which is point 2, which is not in this line at all. We had to step back up here to see where that is. From this point over I, 2 units. There it is. J, 0 units. It should be omitted. All right. Here is a note. Some of you, if you're not extremely careful with your assignment, you will wind up with a machine that says IJK error. Okay? And what that means is not every collection of number, not just any, you can't just put any numbers you want to in here. You can't put numbers that are almost right. The numbers have to be right to the fourth decimal place. Okay? So this code will run. This code will not, because here we've said we want to go to X2.0001, which is just to the right of where this P3 was originally. And notice that if we have an arc that starts at P2 and its center is 1 unit away, not 1, 2 units away, then this is not a possible ending point. This cannot be where that arc ends. It is mathematically impossible. And the machine will check to 4 decimal places. Okay? My advice to you, if you can do it, is to pick easy to calculate points, do them in AutoCAD, get the numbers to the 4th decimal place. Okay? That's my advice, because if you don't have nice even numbers where it's easy to see that something's not right, then by golly, use CAD. This is especially true when you have arcs that don't end on a nice tangent like this. This happens to be tangent, okay? If you had an arc that was tipped in space just a little bit, and it's certainly valid to do such a thing, you just have to be careful about how you calculate the points. That's the hard part. Understanding the code is not the hard part. Finding the right coordinates is the hard part. Do it carefully. All right. Here is another example. In this case, we want a full circle. IJK method allows us to do this. Okay, we want to start at point 1. We want to go to point 2. Okay, let's have a look. Point 1, we go, it's x negative 1, negative 2, 0. So wherever our machine was, it takes us to point 1. Then we move to a value of y 2.0, absolute mode. So here we go, up here. We are at point 2. Now, we ask for an arc, G2. This is a clockwise arc. We don't even give it a destination. Why? Because the X won't change and the Y won't change. They are the same point. What changes, what we do have to command, is the position of the arc center. So this arc is rotated 45 degrees over, and it has a 1-inch radius. So the X value of that is 0.7071. Over in the X, 0.7071 from the start point to the center point. Notice in this case, it's to the left, so it's negative, and there you see the negative. The J is the distance in the Y from the start point to the center point, so that distance is another 0.707, this time positive, because it's up like this. Okay? For your information, the radius is 2. The diameter of this thing is 2. It has a 1-inch radius, but that doesn't go into our code here at all, okay? Because the controller will work out the math, and it will make this sweep around like that, okay? So that's a full circle using IJK. Now, the R method, if you've got your choice, the R method is a lot easier, okay? Here's how the R method works. We'll first go to point 1. That's X3, Y negative 2, Z 0. So, okay, so we ramp. We get here on the page, and we're at negative 3, Y negative 2, Z 0. Then we go to point 2. We command a G1 move to Y1. So here it goes, absolute mode. There he is. Now we're at point 2. G3 is the end point, just like it was before. In this case, we're going backwards, or we're going counterclockwise, and we're going to end at X1, Y3. So over 1 and up 3 is where we end, and we go counterclockwise, just like this, and we've asked for a radius, the radius of 2, okay? So we don't have to calculate where the center is. The controller will do those calculations for us. We've just asked for a radius. The question, does any radius value work here? Well, it can be bigger than this. That will be fine, as long as it still fits in the envelope of the machine. But there's a limit in terms of size that it can be. So the radius has to be greater than or equal to the half of the distance between the two points. Okay, so if the radius is too small, it will throw an error. If it's too big, that can happen too, but that's generally because of the machine working limits, the envelope of the machine. All right, now the clever student might be saying, wait a minute, this code could actually mean two different radiuses, two different arcs. We could have an arc that starts here and that goes, that is 2 inches in radius and ends right here. That arc would look like this, okay? This code would be identical, except for a little convention that we use. So for any of these R value codes, there's going to be a circle that solves the puzzle, that solves these coordinates with an arc that's less than 180 degrees, like we just saw. That arc sweeps out less than 180 degrees. The same exact code, if we didn't have this symbol here, would be greater than 180 degrees. Now, it's entirely within the realm of reason that you would want this, okay? And so if you want the big arc, you'll use this convention. This is just a symbol that says that you want to use the big arc that solves with these coordinates. Okay, so if the arc is the big one, if it's greater than 180 degrees, you'll use this negative symbol. Students screw this up all the time. They put the negative in front of the R. Don't do that, okay? But if you put the R right here where it belongs, there's no such thing as a negative radius, and so they use this symbol to tell the controller we're talking about this other arc. All right, so that's it. That should be able to get you going with your homework. I'll do a separate video for the assignment, but I'm probably not going to beat G2s and G3s to death. So there you have it. And good luck.